transmitting around the world. It's Bob.
Oh, yeah. Well, good morning, everyone. It's Bob. Yeah. we'll leave it at that. Okay, I wanted to start out with Psalm 1:3. And it's an interesting psalm because, come here, you. It's a prayer for deliverance. And I think it touches all of our hearts at some level. Immediately it's for David, when he is being hunted by King Saul and feels like there's just no hope. Like, this goes on month after month, year after year. And he says, I did nothing wrong, which he didn't. But yeah, he's being hunted. And so we can kind of identify with this as we hear it. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I struggle in my soul at night and have sorrow in my heart during the day? How long will my enemies rise up against me? Look at me. Answer me. Lord my God, give light to my eyes. Otherwise, I will sleep in death. Otherwise, my enemies will say, I have overcome him. Otherwise, my persecutor will rejoice when I am shaken. As for me, I have trusted in your gracious love. My heart will rejoice in your deliverance. I will sing to the Lord, who has dealt bountifully with me. And I think it was just last week we were studying where it said, you know, praise the Lord in all conditions. That was on the Bible study. That's where it was. Yeah, and it doesn't seem right. Everything has gone wrong. There is no hope. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And it takes a little bit of willpower to do that. If you ever find yourself in that position, if you can read the Bible and praise the Lord, it always seems to lift your heart, your spirits, and you find your answer when all else seems not to be available. You find your answer. Mm. It was interesting. I was doing a study for our Wednesday night Bible study. And one of the sources I ran across was Chuck Misler. And Chuck was teaching on Zechariah, which happens to be the book we're working on. And he related that the night before, this was set in 1979, just to place it back 40 years, almost 40 years. He was relating that the night before, he and his wife had attended a lecture by Henry Kissinger. And Henry Kissinger said, we're not going to last much longer. We are in trouble because our current administration, which was Jimmy Carter at the time, is simply not handling the world. And the world is falling apart. And it's almost certain that there will be thermonuclear war. And we're not going to survive past 1985. And guess what? The Lord raised up Ronald Reagan. And everything changed. And then I was thinking, well, gosh, not long ago we were saying, well, you know, can we take another Barack Obama and all of the troubles that we're getting into? And the fact that all around the world, our enemies are building up new nuclear weapons and armies against us. And the Lord raised up Donald Trump. Changes everything. And by the way, have you noticed that the guy is brilliant? Yes. He uses his tweets to bury his enemies. Uh-huh. They seem so silly and they seem so stupid. And yet they target someone. And sure enough, that person makes a foolish mistake because they think that they're being targeted by this nincompoop in the office. Somebody said, well, he tends to let people dig a hole deep enough that they're in over their head, and then he buries them. And did you notice how we handled Kim Jong-un? What is the other name for him?
Rocket Man.
Well, that was a deliberate, that was very deliberate because he had analyzed Kim Jong-un and realized one of his weaknesses was his pride. And by hitting him in his pride and, you know, saying, I got a bigger button than you've got and not, silliness like that, made him mad. And what did he do? He trotted out all of his nuclear secrets and showed us everything he had. See, I got nuclear weapons too. And now suddenly we're in a perfect position to counter anything he does. Brilliant. Brilliant. Let your enemies dig a hole, and when they're in over their head, bury them. Okay. So that was the answer to Barack Obama that God gave us. No question about it. Now, if we look at the situation, the times we're in, things seem very uncertain. But we have certainty in the scripture that tells us, oh, something special is coming. Now, admittedly, back when Chuck Misler was talking, it really sounded good when Wiseman, I believe it was, wrote the book 88 Reasons Why the Rapture's in 1988. I read the book, and it was absolutely right on. Every reason was correct. It turned out that the premise was wrong. We know all these years later. Has it been 30 years? My goodness. I can't believe it's been 30 years since he wrote that. But it turns out that in the world, things are even more aligned than they ever were. And every week, Charlie gives us the prophecy update, and we see the alignments happening exactly as the Bible said. And so when's it going to happen? We don't know. And why don't we know? Why didn't the Lord put it in his scripture to tell us? Actually, he put it in there very clearly. He said, if the good man of the house had known when the thief was coming, he wouldn't have allowed his goods to be stolen. Okay, we are the goods. The good man of the house is the devil. And I can conclude from that that if the devil knew exactly when the rapture was going to occur, he would throw everything into making sure that it didn't happen. Now, I don't understand heavenly spiritual things, how that would be possible, but that's what the Bible indicates. And so for that reason, there is going to come a time when the fullness of the Gentiles, all the Gentiles that will accept the Lord, have accepted the Lord, and the Father will say to the Son, go get them. Okay. And then I thought about that a little bit. I said, you know, there's a couple of things that we ought to look at because we are ambassadors for Christ. I have a problem with the second commandment. Most people say, oh, you shouldn't swear. Okay. Well, you shouldn't. You know, that's not a very good use of your tongue. But it says, you know, do not take the Lord's name in vain. And we call ourselves Christians. And so we've taken the name of the Lord. We've become ambassadors for the Lord in vain. Do we carry that out? Do we proclaim his good news? Something to think about. The second commandment may be deeper than anybody realized. Don't just take the name of the Lord and say, I'm a Christian. I've given my life to the Lord. Do something with it, okay? Now that you've done that, do something with it. Because Paul says in Ephesians, I am an ambassador in bonds. Therefore, I speak boldly. That was his take. I'll be bold and I'm an ambassador. Now, here's a question. What do countries do when they're about to go to war with another country? They recall their ambassadors. Correct. Exactly what happens. Oh, wait a minute. We're ambassadors for the Lord. What's he going to do? Recall us. Say, come back to home where it's safe. Okay. And then I had a couple of thoughts about that actual event. In Corinthians, it says, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash and a twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet. Okay. I have seen that portrayed many, many times that everybody just goes poof and vanishes. No, that's not exactly what it says. I mean, Charlie has taught me, read carefully what it says. It says that we will be changed in a flash, in a twinkling of an eye. The transformation from this decaying, imperishable body to the imperishable, immortal will happen in a flash, in a twinkling of an eye. You'll suddenly be a new person. Wow. But does the entire process of the dead coming out of the graves, of being called home, does all that happen in a twinkling of an eye? Not necessarily. There could be some time involved. We don't know, but don't count on everything happening in an instant, because it may not. There may be some time in there. And I'll tell you one thing, another one, is that when 1 Thessalonians discusses it, the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God. What did Christ do when he brought forth Lazarus from the grave? He said, Lazarus, come forth. On the road to Damascus, when he called Paul, called Saul, renamed him Paul, what did the people hear that were there with him in the caravan? Thunder. They heard thunder. In other words, they didn't hear the words the Lord was speaking. They heard thunder. So what are the other people, the unbelievers, going to hear when the Lord calls our name? Because I think that that's kind of indicating he's going to call each person by name. Come up here. Okay. Jim, come up here. Charlie, come up here. Yeah, and it's going to be very personal. And, you know, I can't think of anything that would touch you to the heart more than to hear your name called by the Lord Almighty. I don't think anybody's going to refuse that at that point. That's going to happen. So there's some exciting things coming, but just remember that everybody thought some exciting things were happening and it was about to be the end back in 1979. Okay. 40 years have gone by. I've gotten older. I don't know anybody else. And so can I count on this happening this year? Next year? No. See, that's the thing. I can't count on when it's going to happen. I know it's going to happen. I just don't know when. And what does he say? Occupy until I come. All right, so continue to be an ambassador for the Lord so that when the time comes, he calls you home.
Thank you, Bob.